Good morning. We are so glad you're here this morning. I hope you are ready to celebrate. That's what we're here for today, for sure. The announcements have been running behind me. There's a few in your bulletin as well, and we'll have a special one in just a second. I want to welcome you here and just say, man, we're glad you're here today. And if this is your first time to join us, thank you for being here. We have a gift for you at our welcoming desk, so please stop by and they'll answer any questions you have. If you wouldn't mind, take a moment. There's a little red folder at the end of each pew. If you wouldn't mind just signing your attendance, and if you have any prayer requests or any of those type things, please don't hesitate to put those on. I do want to invite you next Sunday during the Sunday school hour. It's a come and go deal, so if you're in Sunday school, maybe you can either go a little late or leave a little early. We are going to have a reception honoring our newcomers who just finished the newcomers class today. An informal opportunity to get to know each other and talk a little bit, so we want to invite you to that. We also have a reception immediately following this service where we're going to honor our graduating seniors. I hope that you have had a chance to run down to the fellowship hall and see their displays. They're beautiful. See the little biographies that we have in the narthex that they each wrote, as well as a little message. There's a board in the hall right there behind you that talks about all the scholarships that will be given away today, and that's pretty exciting. It talks about maybe the story of who they're named after or how they came about. So please, if you don't, please stop by that reception when we're done, okay? Well, I'd like to invite up Kim Russell, who's got an announcement for us this morning. 21.
Good morning. I am excited to give you guys the opportunity to fulfill part of your promise to the church when you became members, or your promise as believers, and that is the pledge to be present in your prayers. So as you guys know, the United Methodist Church has a general conference every 4 years, and that general conference is the time when delegates from all over the world, there's 846 delegates from all over the world, are going to meet together in Portland, Oregon, and they're going to be planning the direction of the United Methodist Church worldwide for the next 4 years. Huge deal, lots of legislation coming up, and we can participate even without being there in body by our prayers, and we are called to do that. And on the United Methodist website, there's a specific website that they have for us, the 60daysofprayer.org. Look in your bulletins and pull this thing out to get the orange thing. Okay, it gives you the website to go to, that they have tons of helps about prayer. And then on the back of that, there's an opportunity for you to make a commitment. There's an opportunity for you to make a commitment. Okay, all of us need to commit. You can commit generally to just pray. I commit to pray. But then there are two other opportunities. One is you can commit to pray for a certain amount of time every day, starting now and through the end of the conference. And then they're asking us also to pray for 11 days post the conference. When a bunch of decisions are made, there are going to be people that are happy about that, and there are going to be people that are not happy about the decisions that are made. And yet we want unity, and so they're asking us to pray through May 29th. In addition, our church has decided to pray collectively for 24-hour prayer vigil on May 9th, which is the day just prior to the conference. And so we're giving you the opportunity on this form to say when you plan to pray. Go ahead and fill in the time during May 9th, which is a Monday, that you plan to pray. When you fill that out, you can put it in the offering plate. I'll be at the education desk in the back over here on my left-hand side. As we leave, you can give it to me. There will be more opportunities for you to turn those in. You can turn them in the church office. And when we get down to the end where I need 3 o'clock in the morning filled and 4 o'clock in the morning filled, then we'll be more specific about times. But if you want to designate your time now. So make sure you grab this out of your bulletin, fill it out, and take advantage of this opportunity specifically to fulfill your commitment to pray in this church. Thank you.
Thank you.
please stand and join me in the call to worship? Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before him with joyful songs.
Know that the Lord is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people, the sheep of his pasture.
Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name.
For the Lord is good, and his love endures forever. His faithfulness continues through all generations.
We begin in the name of the Lord who made us.
Let us sing and worship together as we praise God's holy name.
Let's walk around, greet each other, and welcome each other in Christian love this morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I'm going to take a few moments just to introduce to you our seniors this Sunday morning. It's a privilege for me. I've only been here for 6 weeks, so I don't know a lot of these kids real well, but I've gotten to know a few of them well, but it doesn't matter. It's a great morning to recognize those seniors. We want to take the time to recognize them and to present them with their scholarships this morning. I want to read a scripture to you real quick that's going to hopefully it will help when we get to that point of Ellen's sermon. Her sermon this morning is about the the beauty of education in the church. And I want to read this to you from Psalm 145, verse 3 and following. Great is the Lord and most worthy of praise. His greatness no one can fathom. One generation will commend your works to another. They will tell of your mighty acts. They will speak of your glorious they will speak of your glorious splendor, of your majesty, and I will meditate on your wonderful works. This morning, it's an honor for us to say congratulations, graduating seniors. Congratulations, and to say that you now are handed the stick. The baton is yours, and to pass on the wonderful works of our God, our Savior, to the next generation. This church has done that for you. They have handed you the baton. They have taught you, and now they're handing you the baton. It is your turn to take that baton and pass it on to the next generation. This morning, I want to recognize our seniors and just call them by name, and I've lost my list. Right there. Thank you. I had it when I walked up here. I lost it when I got here. And I'm just going to have... Barb, where are you? Do I need to... I'm going to answer a question. Could y'all excuse me for just a moment? Again, my first time to do this here, so give me just a second, and I'll compose myself and not embarrass myself or you anymore. I want to call up our seniors. Matthew Agee. Matthew, would you come to the front, please? Ma'am, and the scholarship. Yes, ma'am. This is the Winona Bennett Scholarship. Matthew is a recipient of the Winona Bennett Scholarship. Excuse me, I'm on the wrong list. Some of these guys will be coming back more than once. The next scholarship that we'd like to recognize is the Beth Freeman Scholarship. I know that we have a representative of the Freeman Foundation here. The first recipient of that scholarship is Blair Hambrick. The next scholar, we have two recipients of the Freeman, and this also is Kate McAlpin. Thank you, sir. Thank you, Kate. Our next scholarship will be the Rex and Lorraine Jackson Scholarship. Rex and Lorraine Jackson, Peyton Emery. Peyton, would you please join us at the front? The next scholarship that we'd like to award is the Lee and Jack Reisner Scholarship. Blakely Swope. Next scholarship is the Gerald Snyder Scholarship. Blakely, just come on back. I would have told you to stay, but I lost my place on the list here. Blakely is the recipient of the Gerald Snyder Scholarship. Our next scholarship is the Martha Todd Scholarship. Caitlin Norton, would you please? Our next scholarship is the UMW Scholarship. The UMW Scholarship goes to Bethany Stafford. Bethany, I did not cry.
Yet.
The next scholarship, and we have three recipients here, is the Maisie Walker Scholarship. The first, and... Here we go, sorry. Firstly, the first recipient is Caitlin Norton. second recipient is Blair Hambrick. The third recipient is Kate McAlpin. Our next scholarship is from the fellowship class. The recipient there is Caitlin Norton. Excuse me. Our next scholarship is from our music ministry, and the recipient is Blair Hambrick. The last scholarship that we give is the FUMC scholarship, and I would like to ask all the seniors that we called earlier, Matthew, Peyton, Blair, Kate, Caitlin, Blakely, and Bethany to come. The front. Because of your generosity, church, and because of the generosity of these incredible scholarship sponsors, we were able to give out over $13,000 worth of scholarships this year to these seven seniors. Two other seniors who did not apply for scholarships, and I'm not sure that they're here or not, Katie Kirkpatrick and John Spillman. If you two guys are here, come to the front. I don't think that I didn't see them earlier today. So, seniors, will you stay here? And parents, would you come and join your senior at the altar rail? Guys, just spread them on the rail. We want to pray over you this morning. And church, as the parents are doing that. If you want to come, I'm doing this on my own. If you want to come and extend your hands over or lay hands on these and pray with them, please feel free to. You have had a great impact on these seniors, and they're not just mom and dad seniors; they're yours as well. So if you'd like to come and pray with them, please do.
This is awesome, and I want to say a word. First of all, Roger, 6 weeks on the job, and you know all these kids. I'm just thankful that you're doing the incredible job you are. That is amazing. And I also want to say a word of appreciation to Barb Soul, because Barb has spent way more hours than I can imagine on this process. And a brief word that after this service, there will be a reception. I think John mentioned that earlier, so I'm going to mention it again just to remind you. So let us now pray over these incredible young people as they prepare on their journey. Loving God, we give you thanks for these wonderful kids, for the blessing they've been in our lives all these years, for their parents as they go through this time of transition, because we know that it's hard to prepare a senior to leave, and it's hard to stay when they leave. And so, Lord, just bless them, be with them, and guide them in every step they take. Lord, we give you thanks for what you have done in the lives of each of these young persons. We thank you, O God, that you know them so well, that you know exactly what they need, you know where they're going, and you will be with them, and your Spirit will remain upon them. Thank you, dear God, for that gift. Thank you, O God, for the gifts that you have placed in each of these young persons. May they fulfill those gifts, O God. May they follow your path in all that they do. We thank you, O God, for who they are and who you have called them to be. We ask that you bless them on this journey, bless their families, give them comfort and strength. And Lord, may we as a church family never cease to pray for them as they make this transition. In the strong name of Jesus Christ, we pray, and the church said, Amen. Amen. Thank you, Roger and Barb. Thank you.
to be late for lunch, but I'm going to take this opportunity. I'd like every single person except the seniors to stand. Except the seniors. Now, seniors, stand up, please. Stand up for seniors. Senior, all these people here love you. They will be praying for you as you go your way. When there's hard times, think of these people and all their prayers. Go in peace. Amen.
Amen.
Thanks, Fred. I'd like to invite up the seniors of the future and all the children to come up real quick for a quick children's time. So please come. It's good to see y'all this morning. Welcome. All right, I got a question for you. Not everybody's going to be able to say yes, but if you were here last week and we had these, who did what I asked them to do? You did? You did? Good job. Awesome. What did I ask y'all to do for those who weren't here? I asked you to get two lollipops, one for yourself and one for somebody else, to go and give it to them. And what were you supposed to say, Samuel, when you gave it to him?
Here you go.
Here you go. And God loves you. That's right. Good job. Good job. Well, here's the deal, friends. We're going to do it again. All right? Just a second ago, we celebrated all those seniors. And I want y'all to look around. Y'all look out real quick. Can y'all look out that way? All right. This is a little chance to say thank you to some people. If you taught Sunday school, worked in the nursery, worked in the youth group, worked in the children's ministry, for any of those children that just graduated or are about to graduate, would you stand up? So if you were a Sunday school teacher over the last 17, 18 years or worked with the youth group, maybe you prayed for them for different things. Maybe you helped support them with on mission trips, or maybe you went on mission trips with some of them. We want to say thank you to all of y'all. So you see these people? These are the people that make us who we are. Thank you, guys. But one thing we're talking about in church today, friends, is that we're talking about learning and teaching others about God's love. That's our number one job. Did you know that? And so what I want you to do is I want you each to take two of these again. Not yet. Good job. You didn't get in trouble. Two of these again. One you can have for yourself if you want it. And one to give to somebody who doesn't go to church here. Give that lollipop to him and say, you know what? God loves you, and here's a gift. Can you do that for me? All right. And that's us starting to teach, and that's what we're going to work on today. Okay? Will you pray with me? Dear God, thank you so much for loving us.
Help us
to share your love.
With everyone.
Amen.
Amen.
Yay, Jesus. Okay, hold up. Brayson's going to take these out there, and each of you get two. So follow Brayson, okay? And Natalie. Once again, adults. There's plenty of dum-dums for you to share God's love with as well. Pick them up on the way out. As the ushers come forward, would you pray with me? Almighty God, we do thank you for all the gifts you have poured out on us. Lord, as we give back to you our tithes and offerings, we ask, Lord, that you take them and you bless them, that you use them to share your love with this world. Help us to be the teachers of God's love for this world. In your Son's name we pray. Amen. Today for our celebration, I want to celebrate education. And within our church, today is our day. We are remembering all those who teach Sunday school, whether it's for our wee little babies in the nursery, all the way to those who have a lot more experience on this earth, and everyone in between. And we have tables out in the narthex with our adult education, our children's education. We encourage you to stop by. Ellen will talk a little more about that in her sermon. But you know what? We aren't doing anything if we're not growing and learning as disciples. And I celebrate all our teachers, all those who have taught, and all those students. Because you know what? As a teacher, it's hard to teach when there aren't any students. So I thank you for being part of our Bible studies and being part of our children's, our youth's, and our adults' lives. So for that, I say thanks be to God. Would you join me? Thanks be to God. Now will you stand and join me in the doxology.
Thank you.
guess it would help if I turned my mic on, huh? Let us pray together. Loving God, there is such a sweet, sweet spirit here today. And such a powerful presence that you have in our midst. And we thank you for that. We thank you, O God, for the blessings you pour upon us. Forgive us, O God, when we sometimes take those for granted. We just assume those things will be there. Instead of falling on our knees and giving thanks that you provide for our needs. This morning, O God, we are blessed with these fine men and women who are graduating from high school and about to depart for the military or for college or for a job. Lord, I am convinced that you have called these young people to great things. So I pray that you will bless them and equip them, O God, for whatever task you lay before them. Be with their families, their parents, their grandparents, their church family as they leave us. And let us never fall down on our commitment to pray for them. We pray also, O God, for our country. The United States of America doesn't feel very united right now. So we pray that you will be with us and that you will unite us as a nation. In the midst of this election year and all the rhetoric on TV, Lord, help us to know what to do. Help us to know who you have called to serve as our leader in this country. And bless and equip them for that task. In a similar way, O God, we pray for those who go to General Conference in Portland in the coming days. Because what they do will form and shape who we are for the next 4 years. And so be with them. Grant them travel mercies. Give them your wisdom and your spirit of discernment in their decision making. We thank you for everyone who has agreed to be a delegate because it is a huge commitment. So inspire and equip them, O God, for what is before them. We pray for those, O God, in our church family and in our community and in our circle of life that are ill. Some who are struggling today and are in the hospital. We pray for those who are undergoing treatments, waiting for test results, waiting for a doctor to tell them what they're going to do. We pray for our shut-ins who are in nursing homes or assisted living facilities or who are at home in the care of those who love them. Help all of those persons know how much we love them, O God. Be with them, O God, and grant them healing for whatever it is they need this day. Thank you for that, O God. Thank you for your faithfulness in our life and for your constant presence in our life. Help us to see that, to sense that, to feel that. We are so thankful, O God, and as thankful people, we pray the prayer that your Son, our Savior, taught us when he said, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
Good morning.
Good morning.
The scripture this morning is Luke 5, verses 1 through 11. You may follow along on the screen, or you may find it in the Pew Bible on New Testament page 62. Jesus is calling his first disciples. Once, while Jesus was standing beside the lake of Gennesaret, and the crowd was pressing in on him to hear the word of God, he saw two boats there at the shore of the lake. The fishermen had gone out of them and were washing their nets. He got into one of the boats, the one belonging to Simon, and asked him to put out a little way from the shore. Then he sat down and taught the crowds from the boat. When he had finished speaking, he said to Simon, "Put out into the deep water and let down your nets for a catch." Simon answered, "Master, we have worked all night long, but have caught nothing. Yet, if you say so, I will let down the nets." When they had done this, they caught so many fish that their nets were beginning to break. So they signaled their partners in the other boat to come and help them. And they came and filled both boats so that they began to sink. But when Simon Peter saw it, he fell down at Jesus' knees, saying, "Go away from me, Lord, for I am a sinful man." For he and all who were with him were amazed at the catch of fish that they had taken. And so also were James and John, sons of Zebedee, who were partners with Simon. Then Jesus said to Simon, "Do not be afraid. From now on, you will be catching people." When they had brought their boats to shore, they left everything and followed him. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Nancy. My friends, won't you pray with me? Holy and loving God, we give you thanks for your word. We give you thanks for the power of your word. We ask, O God, that you be with us as we meditate on these words. And may the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts together be acceptable in your sight. Because you, O God, are our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Before I start, I forgot to say something. I'm going to end with a poem. I think it's particularly appropriate for the days of our seniors. If you want a copy, I'd be glad to get one for you. I think it's very, very appropriate. But first of all, as a pastor, I wear a lot of hats, right? And as a pastor, I try to do all those things really well. Guess what? I don't. A lot of balls get dropped. And I don't intend for that to happen. It just does. Pastor John probably experienced that. Pastor Tommy probably experiences that because we just juggle a lot of hats. We have many roles. Jesus, on the other hand, wore those hats and juggled those hats perfectly. Everything was always exactly the way he intended. For 3 years, he journeyed around what we now call the Holy Land, and he preached what was right. He taught what was true, and he healed what was wrong. So many things that he addressed in his 3 years, we think about 3 years. There are many scriptural examples to this, especially in the gospel writings, but this morning I want to look at two. One is the one we have on the board, but before we get to that one, I want to look at one from Mark. And Michelle, don't worry, it's not on the screens. There's a story there of the feeding of the multitudes. And what we tend to do is we skip over the preliminary verses and we go right to the miracle of the feeding of the multitudes. But this morning I want us to look at verses 30 through 34 before we get to that point. Here's just a few nuggets. I'm not going to read it all. The apostles gathered around Jesus and told him all they had done and taught. He said to them, "Come away to a deserted place all by yourselves and rest for a while." And they went away on a boat to a deserted place by themselves. Many saw them going, and they hurried there on foot from the towns and arrived ahead of them. As he went on shore, he saw a great crowd, and he had compassion on them, because they were like sheep without a shepherd. And he began to teach many things. Brothers and sisters, did you hear that? He had compassion on them, And he began to teach them many things, even though he was tired, even though he was exhausted emotionally and physically. They decided to get away. They were tired, they wanted a break, so they go around to the other side. The crowds did what? They followed them. Y'all are already doing better than first service, who just slept through the whole sermon. Must have been terrible. He had compassion on them because, I love the way they put this, they were like sheep without a shepherd. Just lost. You know people like that? That are sometimes just not sure where they're going or what they're doing. Remember that Jesus was fully human and also fully divine. Now his humanity was tired, but his divinity overrode his humanity. And even though he was really physically tired in his human state, his divine desire to teach took precedence. This lesson this morning describes a similar story. We're told that Jesus was standing by the Lake of Gennesaret, and again the crowd was pressing in on him to hear him teach. And he got into the boat, and he sat down, and he began to teach the crowds from the boat. When he finished teaching, he told Simon, "Put out into the deep water and let down your nets for a catch." Now, just for a moment, put yourself in Simon's shoes. They've been fishing all night. They're exhausted. They're probably frustrated because they've not been successful. If you've ever gone fishing and not caught anything, it's pretty frustrating, isn't it? But that's why they call it fishing, not catching, right? That's what my husband always says. Nonetheless, Simon followed through. If you don't mind, Michelle, could you put up verse 5? Simon replied in verse 5 saying, "Master, we have worked all night long and have caught nothing." And here's the phrase I want you to see. "Yet if you say so." "Yet if you say so, I will let down the nets." Brothers and sisters, say that with me if you would. "Yet if you say so." What does that mean? I'm going to do what you say. I'm obedient. I'm going to follow through. You see, at that time, Simon Peter could have said, "Look, Jesus, we're the fishermen. You're the carpenter. You stick to woodwork. I'll take care of the fishing. We're going to go home now." "Yet if you say so, you're the carpenter. You do woodwork, but if you say so." I think that is so powerful. I think that is so strong. He demonstrated faith and trust in the Master because he had been with him. He'd seen him teach and heal and bring comfort to those in need. He'd witnessed with his own eyes Jesus' power, Jesus' compassion, Jesus' ability to do amazing things. And so that's why he said, "Yet if you say so, I will let down the nets." When I think about these stories, I'm reminded that even in Jesus' most exhausted times, he saw the need to teach and to proclaim and to share the stories of God. Now remember, there was no Bible in those days. This was all oral tradition. But he shared all of these stories and he had incredible compassion, especially in that story a moment ago from Luke. In his compassion, in the story here, in his exhaustion, he saw the need to teach. Now, brothers and sisters, I'm not the sharpest knife in the drawer, okay? But this isn't rocket science. Jesus taught, and so that means we are to do what? To teach and to learn, yes. We are to be students and we are to be teachers. That is what we've been called to do. From our little ones in our early Christian awareness class, do you know that we have 6 months olds in Sunday school? That's just amazing to me. But I know Janice has told me, and I know that Glenna tells me, they tell those children, God loves you. And if they don't hear anything else, if they don't understand anything else between 6 and 18 months in early Christian awareness, they know God loves you. That is powerful. And so we are called to teach those little babies as much as we're called to teach our teens through our youth program and our Sunday school program. We're called to teach in the children who come here to Sunday school, the children who come here on Wednesday for breakout. Brothers and sisters, many of those children who come here on Wednesday don't have church. That is their church. We're called to teach those children who come here for vacation Bible school for 1 week in June. We have 1 week to help them learn because most of those children do not have a church. And so their parents bring them to us, and we are entrusted with them for a week, and we are called to teach. Remember that awesome verse, Proverbs 22:6, train up a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it. Brothers and sisters, we are called to teach and to train. What a wonderful example of our calling to teach children the way of Christ. If they don't learn anything else while they're here, they know God loves them. And that's huge. So that when they face the mountains and the challenges in their life, they know that God's love will override all of that and help guide them through those mountains. Doesn't make them go away, but it guides them as they cross the mountains. Many years ago, before I came here and before some of you came here, this church made an intentional decision to be a welcoming congregation. And what I mean by that is our doors are open day and night for all kinds of groups that meet here. It is amazing. If you come up here any night, you will see people in AA or square dancing or ballroom dancing. You will see people in parenting classes or Weight Watchers or Master Gardeners or Master Naturalists or Quilters. That's one of my favorite. When you drive up in the morning and the parking lot's full, oh, the Quilters are here. You just know. And we're called to be a witness to all of them in the way we live our life, in the way we demonstrate our faith. That is another importance on teaching, I think. And to be witnesses of the gospel. Are you called to teach? Are you called to be witnesses of the gospel in our hallways, not just on Sunday morning, but on Tuesday afternoon and Wednesday night and Thursday morning? All of those times when people are in our building, I've been making phone calls. I've got a list on my desk, and I'm calling people because we need some summer Sunday school teachers for our children. We have teachers that teach all year long, all during the school year, I mean. And we need people who will give those teachers a break in the summer. And so some of you are on my target list, and if you've not gotten a call already, you might go ahead and call me and head that off at the pass. And say, Pastor, I'm willing to teach in the summer, because what it means is you have an opportunity to be with those incredible children for 3 months of the year. Or maybe you can just say, you know, I'm going to be gone some this summer, but I can teach in July. That's great. You work in rotation. That is your opportunity to mold and shape these children in a way that will change your life as well. Today on this Senior Sunday, we see the fruits of your labors, as many of you have taught and formed and shaped these students. And though at times I'm sure you felt exhausted as Jesus did, you understand the importance and the significance, because today is the culmination of that. Today these students come before us and they are transitioning. Students, you're seated all over the room. The education doesn't stop now. It just shifts. It's an opportunity for you to go to the university and find a student ministry center, or to go to a church in the community where you will be studying, or to a military chapel if maybe you are going into the military. Brothers and sisters in the church family, you have planted seeds. Now it is up to these young people, as Roger said so appropriately, to pass the baton to these young people. So to those of you who graduate and we celebrate today, remember the things that you have been taught by those who love you so much. Whether you're going to Tarleton or A&M or UT, wherever life takes you, if you're going to Blinn, whether you're going to Texas State, all of these places, God is there, I have news for you. And He will continue to be with you. Take the seeds of faith that we have tried to plant in you. Take those seeds. It's up to you as adult to continue that education process. Recognize also that it's hard for those you leave behind in Marble Falls, right? We're going to cry when you leave. That just goes with the territory. I'm going to warn you right now. I'm going to cry when you leave. Your mom and dad are going to cry when you leave. That goes with it. For everyone, it's a transition. But brothers and sisters, remember this. The will of God will never take you where the grace of God cannot keep you, where the arms of God cannot support you, where the arms of God will be with you and the riches of God cannot supply your needs, where the power of God cannot endow you. The will of God will never take you where the Spirit of God cannot work through you, where the wisdom of God cannot teach you, where the army of God cannot protect you, where the hands of God cannot mold you. The will of God will never take you where the love of God cannot enfold you, where the mercies of God cannot sustain you, where the peace of God cannot calm your fears, where the authority of God cannot overrule for you. The will of God will never take you where the comfort of God cannot dry your tears, where the word of God cannot feed you, where the miracles of God cannot be done for you, where the omnipresence of God cannot find you. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Loving and mighty God, thank you, thank you, thank you. Be with us, O God, as we prepare to say goodbye to our seniors. Help them to always remember on the most difficult exam day or the most difficult challenge day how much they are loved in Marble Falls. Thank you for the opportunity you have given us to be a part of their lives. Thank you for your word. May it fill them, may it equip them for all that is to come. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. As we prepare to close our service, we're going to sing a hymn about hope as our young people leave us. My hope is built on nothing less. If there are those who would unite with our church family this morning, if there are those who wish to come and pray, we would invite you to come and do that as we stand as we're able to sing this great hymn. Before we leave here today, I want to remember with you, for you, Jack Walters. This week our congregation was touched by death as Jack crossed that line and he went to be with our Heavenly Father. When I moved to Marble Falls 5 years ago, Jack was one of these ones passing the offering plate. He was one of our faithful ushers and he was here every Sunday. He was here early, sometimes one of the first ones before this service. I will always remember his faithfulness. And he inspired me in ways that will continue to impact my life for years to come. Today we transfer his church membership from the church militant in this place To the church triumphant in the arms of our Lord and of his Christ, and we give thanks for Jack. As we do that, let's sing Eagle's Wings as we remember him. Pronounce the benediction, I want to brag on our seniors. They've been here all day. They've been here all day, and I told some of them, y'all get a pass if you want to slip out and then come back for the reception. They're all here. They had to listen to my sermon twice. So give them an extra hug as you go to the reception in just a few moments, but first receive this benediction. We are called to teach, to proclaim the gospel, to share the love and the power of Almighty God. May we never take that responsibility lightly. Go forth as teachers of God's word. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.